Women Talking by Miriam Toews. June 6th, August Epp before the meeting. My name is August Epp, irrelevant for all purposes. Other than that, I've been appointed the minute taker for the women's meetings because the women are illiterate and unable to do it themselves. And as these are the minutes and I the minute taker, and as I am a school teacher and daily instruct my students to do the same, I feel my name should be included at the top of the page together with the date. Ona Friesen, also of the Malochna colony, is the woman who asked me if I'd take the minutes. Although she didn't use the word minutes, but rather asked if I would record the meetings and create a document pertaining to them. We had this conversation last evening, standing on the dirt path between her house and the shed where I've been lodged since returning to the colony 7 months ago. A temporary arrangement according to Peters, the Bishop of Malochna. Temporary could mean any length of time because Peters isn't committed to a conventional understanding of hours and days. We are here or in heaven for an eternity and that's all we need to know. The main houses in the colony are for families and I am alone, so it is possible I may always forever live in the shed, which doesn't really bother me. It's bigger than a jail cell and large enough for me and a horse. Ona and I avoided the shadows as we spoke. Once in mids and tens, the wind caught her skirt and I felt its hem graze my leg. We sidestepped into the sun again and then again as the shadows lengthened until the sunlight had disappeared and Ona laughed and waved her fist at the setting sun, calling it a traitor, a coward. I grappled with the idea of explaining hemispheres to her, how we are required to share the sun with the other parts of the world, and that if one were to observe the earth from the outer space, one could see as many as 15 sunsets and sunrises in a day, and that perhaps by sharing the sun, the world could learn to share everything, learn that everything belonged to everyone. But instead I nodded, yes, the sun is a coward, like myself. I kept silent too because it was this tendency of mine to believe with such exuberance that we could all share everything that landed me in prison not long ago. The truth is I don't have a catchy method of conversing and yet unfortunately suffer on a minute-to-minute basis the agony of the unexpressed thought. Ona laughed again and her laughter gave me courage and I wanted to ask if I was a physical reminder of evil to her and if that was what the colony considered me, to be evil. Not because I had been in prison, but because of what had happened long ago, before I become incarcerated. Instead, I simply agreed to take the minutes. Of course, I have no choice other than to agree because I would do anything for Ona Friesen. I asked her why the women wanted a record of their meetings if they wouldn't be able to read it. Ona, who is afflicted with narfa or nervousness, as am I, my name Epp coming from aspen, the trembling aspen, the tree with leaves that tremble, the tree that is sometimes called the women's tongue because its leaves are in constant motion, said this in response. She had seen two animals earlier, very early in the morning, a squirrel and a rabbit. Ona had watched as the squirrel charged the rabbit, running full tilt. Just as the squirrel was about to make contact with the rabbit leapt straight up into the air, 2 or 3 feet. The squirrel, confused or so Ona thought, then turned around and charged the rabbit from the other direction only to encounter empty space once again as the rabbit, at the very last available second, leapt high into the air, avoiding the contact with the squirrel. I appreciated the story because it was Ona telling it, but I didn't understand exactly why she was telling it or what it had to do with the minutes. They were playing, she told me. Is that so? I asked her. Ona explained perhaps she wasn't meant to have seen the squirrel and rabbit playing. It had been very early in the morning at a time when only Ona was roaming about the colony, her hair too loosely covered, her dress too untidily hemmed, a suspicious figure. the devil's daughter, as Peters has named her. But you did see it, I asked her. The secret playing. Yes, she said. I saw it with my own eyes, which in that moment, in the telling of the story, was shining with excitement. The meetings have been organized hastily by Agatha Friesen and Greta Lowen in response to the strange attacks that have been haunting the women of Malochna for the past several years. Since 2005, nearly every girl and woman has been raped by what many in the colony believe to be ghosts or Satan, supposedly as punishment for their sins. The attacks occurred at night. As their families slept, the girls and women were made unconscious with a spray of the anesthetic used on our farm animals, made from the belladonna plant. The next morning, they would wake up in pain, groggy, and often bleeding, and not understand why. Recently, the 8 demons responsible for the attacks turned out to be real men from Malochna, many of whom are the close relatives, brothers, cousins, uncles. I recognized one of the men barely. He and I had played together when we were children. He knew the names of all the planets, or he made them up anyway. His nickname for me was Proag, which in our language meant question. I remember that I had wanted to say goodbye to this boy before I left the colony with my parents, but my mother told me that he was having difficulty with his 12-year-old molars and had contracted an infection and was confined to his bedroom. I'm not sure now if that was true. In any case, neither this boy nor anybody from the colony said goodbye before we left. The other perpetrators are much younger than me and hadn't been born or were babies or toddlers when I left with my parents, and I have no recollection of them. Malochna, like all our colonies, is self-policed. Initially, Peters planned to lock the men in a shed for several decades, but it soon became apparent that the men's lives were in danger. Ona's younger sister, Salome, attacked one of the men with a scythe, and another man was hanged by a group of drunk and angry colonists, male relatives of the victims, from a tree branch by his hands. He died there, forgotten apparently, when the drunk and angry men passed out in the sorghum field next to the tree. After this, Peters, together with the elders, decided to call in the police and have the men arrested for their own safety, presumably, and taken to the city. The remaining men of the colony, except for the senile or decrepit, and myself for humiliating reasons, have gone to the city to post bail for the imprisoned attackers in the hope that they will be able to return to Malochna while they await trial. And when the perpetrators return, the women of Malochna will be given the opportunity to forgive these men, thus guaranteeing everyone's place in heaven. If the women did not forgive the men, say Peters, the women will have to leave the colony for the outside world, of which they know nothing. The women have very little time, only 2 days to organize their response. Yesterday, as I have been told by Ona, the women of Malochna voted. There were 3 options on the ballot. First, do nothing. Second, stay and fight. Third, leave. Each option was accompanied by an illustration of its meaning because the women do not read. Netje Friesen, aged 16, daughter of the late Mina Friesen and now permanent ward of her aunt Salome Friesen, created the illustrations. Do nothing was accompanied by an empty horizon. Stay and fight was accompanied by a drawing of 2 colony members engaged in a bloody knife duel. And the option of leave was accompanied by a drawing of the rear end of a horse. The vote was a deadlock between numbers 2 and 3, bloody knife duel, and back of horse. The Friesen women predominantly want to stay and fight. The low ones prefer to leave, although evidence of shifting convictions exists in both the camps. There are also some women in Malochna who voted to do nothing, to leave things in the hands of the Lord, but they will not be in attendance today. The most vocal of the do-nothing women is Scarface Jans, a stalwart member of the colony, the resident bone setter, and also a woman for having an excellent eye for measuring distances. She once explained to me that as a Malochnan, she had everything she wanted. All she had to do was convince herself that she wanted very little. Ona has informed me that Siloam Friesen, a formidable iconoclast, had indicated in yesterday's meeting that do-nothing was in reality not an option, but that allowing women to vote for do-nothing would at least be empowering. Mijel Lowen, a friendly chain smoker with two yellow fingertips and what I suspect must be a secret life, had agreed. But Ona told me Mijel also pointed out that Siloam Friesen had not been annotated as the person who can declare what constitutes reality or what the options are. The other Lowen women had apparently nodded their heads at this, while the Friesen women had expressed impatience with quick, dismissive gestures. This type of minor conflict well illustrates the timbre of the debate between the two groups, the Friesens and the Lowens. However, because time is short and the need for a decision urgent, the women of Melochna have agreed collectively to allow these two families to debate the pros and cons of each option, excluding the do-nothing option, which most of the women in the colony dismiss as dumbheit, and to decide which is suitable and finally to choose how best to implement that option. A translation note. The women are speaking in Plattdeutsch or Low German, the only language they know and the language spoken by all the members of the Melochna colony, although the boys of Melochna are now taught rudimentary English in the school. And the men also speak some Spanish. Plattdeutsch is an unwritten medieval language, moribund, a mishmash of German, Dutch, Pomeranian and Frisian. Very few people in the world speak Plattdeutsch, and everyone who does is Mennonite. I mention this to explain that before I can transcribe the minutes of the meetings, I must translate what the women are saying into English so that it may be written down. And one more note, again irrelevant to the women's debate, but necessary to explain in this document why I am able to read, write and understand English. I learned English in England, where my parents went to live after being excommunicated by the Bishop of Melochna. At the time, Peters Sr., father of Peters, the current Bishop of Melochna. While in my fourth year of anniversary there, I suffered a nervous breakdown and became involved in certain political activities for which I was eventually expelled and imprisoned for a period of time. During my imprisonment, my mother died. My father had disappeared years before. I have no siblings because my mother's uterus was removed following my birth. In short, I had no one and nothing in England, although I had managed, while serving time in prison, to complete my teaching degree through correspondence. In dire straits, homeless and self-mad, or fully mad, I made a decision to commit suicide. While researching my various options at the public library nearest the park, in which I made my home, I fell asleep. I slept for an extraordinarily long time and was eventually gently nudged by the librarian, who told me it was time for me to leave. The library was closing. Then the librarian, the old woman, noticed that I'd been crying and that I appeared dishevelled and distraught. She asked me what was wrong. I told her the truth. I didn't want to live anymore. She offered to buy me supper, and while we were dining at the small restaurant across the street from the library, she asked me where I'd come from, what part of the world. I replied that I came from a part of the world that had been established to be its own world, apart from the world. In a sense, I told her, my people don't exist, or at least are supposed to be seen not to. And perhaps it doesn't take too long before you believe that you really don't exist, she said. Or that your actual corporeal existence is a perversity. I wasn't sure what she meant and scratched my head furiously like a dog with ticks. And after that, she asked. University briefly and then prison, I told her. Ah, she said, perhaps the two aren't mutually exclusive. I smiled stupidly. My foray into the world resulted in my removal from the world. Almost as though you were brought into existence not to exist, she said, laughing. Singled out to conform, yes, I said, trying to laugh with her. Born not to be. I imagined my squalling infant self being removed from my mother's womb, and then the womb itself hastily yanked away from her and thrown out a window to prevent any other abominations from occurring. this birth, this boy, his nakedness, her shame, his shame, their shame. I told the librarian that it was difficult to explain where I was from. I met a traveler from an antique land, said the librarian, apparently quoting a poet she knew and loved. Again, I wasn't sure what she meant, but I nodded. I explained that I was originally a Mennonite from the Melochna colony and that when I was 12 years old, my parents were excommunicated and we moved away to England. Nobody said goodbye to us, I told the librarian. For years, I believe we were forced to leave Melochna because I had been caught stealing pears from a farm in the neighboring colony of Chortza. In England, where I learned how to read and write, I spelled my name with rocks in a large green field so that the god would find me quickly and my punishment would be complete. I also tried to spell the word confession with rocks from our garden fence, but my mother Monica had noticed the stone wall between our garden and the neighbors was disappearing. One day she followed me to my green field along the narrow rut that the wheelbarrow had made in the dirt and caught me in the act of surrendering myself to God, using the stones from the fence to signal my location with huge letters. She sat me down on the ground and put her arms around me and said nothing. After a while, she told me that the fence had to be put back. I asked if I could put the stones back after the God had found me and punished me. I was so exhausted from anticipating punishment and I wanted to get it over with. She asked me what I thought God intended to punish me for, and I told her about the peers and about my thoughts regarding girls, about my drawings and my desire to win in sports and be strong, how I was vain and competitive and lustful. My mother laughed then and hugged me again and apologized for laughing. She said that I was a normal boy. I was a child of God, a loving God in spite of what anybody said, but that the neighbors were perturbed about the disappearing fence and I would have to return the stones. All this I told to the librarian. She responded that she could understand why my mother had said what she did, but that if she had been there, if she had been my mother, she would have said something else. She would have told me that I wasn't normal, that I was innocent, yes, but that I had an unusually deep need to be forgiven, even though I had done nothing wrong. Most of us, she said, absolve ourselves of responsibility for change by sentimentalizing our pasts, and then we live freely, happily, or if not altogether happily, without tremendous anguish. The librarian laughed. She said that if she had been in that green field with me, she would have helped me to have that feeling of somehow being forgiven. Forgiven for what? Though exactly, I asked her. Stealing peers, drawing pictures of naked girls? No, no, said the librarian. Forgiven for being alive, for being in the world, for the arrogance and the futility of remaining alive, the ridiculousness of it, the stench of it, the unreasonableness of it. That's your feeling, she added, your internal logic. You've just explained that to me. She went on to say that in her opinion, doubt and uncertainty and questioning are inextricably bound together with faith. A rich existence, she said, a way of being in the world, wouldn't you say? I smiled. I scratched. The world, I said. What do you remember of Melochna? Ona, I said. Ona Friesen. And I began to tell her about Ona Friesen, a girl my age, the same woman who has now asked me to record the minutes of the meeting. After a long conversation with the librarian, during which I talked mostly, though not entirely, about Ona, how we had played, how we had clocked the seasons by the tiny lengthening of the light, how we had pretended to be rebellious disciples, at first misunderstood by our leader, Jesus, and then posthumously hailed as heroes, how we had joisted on horses with hens posts, how we had kissed, how we had fought. The librarian suggested that I return to Melochna, to the place where life had made sense to me, even briefly, even an imaginary play in dying sunlight, and that I asked the bishop to accept me into the colony as a member. I did not tell the librarian that this would also mean asking Peters to forgive me the sins of my parents, sins pertaining to the storage of intellectual materials and to the dissemination and propagation of said materials even though the materials were art books, photographs of paintings that my father had found in the garbage behind a school in the city. And even though he was guilty only of sharing the images with the other colony members, as he was unable to read the text. She also suggested that I offer to teach them Malochna in boys' English, a language that would need in order to conduct business outside the colony. And she said that I should become friends once again with Ona Friesen. I had nothing to lose. I took this advice to heart. The librarian asked her husband to give me a job driving for his airport limousine service. And although I didn't have a valid driver's license, I worked for him for 3 months to make enough money to purchase a ticket to Malochna. During this time, I slept in the attic of a youth hostel. At night, when it felt as though my head was about to explode, I would will myself to lie as still as possible. Every night in that hostel, as I lay motionless in my bed, I closed my eyes and heard very faint strains of piano music, heavy chords, and unaccompanied by voices. One morning I asked the man who cleaned the hostel and who also slept there if he had ever heard faint piano music with heavy chords at night. He said no, never. Eventually I understood that the song I heard at night when it felt as though my head was about to explode was the Haim, Greatness is Thy Faithfulness. And that I was listening to my own funeral. Peters, who wears the same tall black boots his own father once wore, or at least similar ones, considered my request for readmittance into the colony. He finally said he would allow me membership providing I renounced my parents before the elders and was baptized into the church, and agreed to teach the boys basic English and simple math in return for shelter and 3 meals a day. I told Peters I would be baptized and I would teach the boys, but that I wouldn't renounce my parents. Peters, unhappy but desperate to have the boys learn accounting, or perhaps because my appearance unsettled him as I looked so much like my father, agreed. When I arrived in the spring of 2008, there were only whispers, fragments of whispers concerning the mysterious nighttime disturbances. Cornelius, one of my students, wrote a poem called The Washline, in which he described the sheets and garments on his mother's washline as having voices, of speaking with one another, of sending messages to other garments on the other washlines. He read the poem to the class and all the boys laughed. The houses are so far apart and there is no electrical light anywhere inside or out. The houses are small tombs at night. On my way back to my shed that afternoon, I saw the wash lines of Malochna. I saw the women's dresses flapping in the wind and the men's overalls and the linens and the bedding and the towels. I listened carefully, but I couldn't make out what they were saying. Perhaps I now think because they weren't talking to me, they were talking to each other. In the year after I arrived, the women described dreams they'd been having. And then eventually, as the pieces fell into place, they came to understand that they were collectively dreaming one dream and that it wasn't a dream at all. The women in the Friesen and Lohan families who have gathered for today's meeting represent 3 generations each and all have been repeat victims in the attacks. I've done some simple calculations. Between 2005 and 2009, more than 300 girls and women of the Malochna were made unconscious and attacked in their own beds. On average, an attack occurred every 3 or 4 days. Finally, Liesel Nistrader forced herself to stay awake night after night until she caught a young man prying upon her bedroom window, holding a jug of Belladonna spray in one hand. Liesel and her adult daughter wrestled the man to the ground and tied him up with baler twine. Later that morning, Peters was brought to the house to confront this young man, Gerhard Schellenberg, and Gerhard named the other 7 men involved in the attacks. Nearly every female member of the Malochna colony has been violated by this group of 8, but most, except for the 8, for the girls too young to understand these proceedings, and the women led by Scarface Jans, who have already chosen to exercise the do-nothing option, have marked an X next to their name to indicate that they are content not to attend the meetings about how to respond. Instead, they will contribute to the well-being of the colony by tending to the cores, which are manifold now while the men are away, and which, if abandoned for as little as one day, will result in mayhem, especially when it comes to milking and feeding of animals. The youngest and speediest women in both Friesen and Lowen families, Orchi and Netchi, have agreed to provide the other women in the colony with oral reports at the end of the day when all are black in their houses. Now, in the hayloft of the barn where we have quietly gathered in the morning, I wait to do as Ona has asked of me. June 6, minutes of the women talking. We begin by washing each other's feet. This takes time. We each wash the feet of the person sitting to our right. The foot washing was a suggestion made by Agatha Friesen, mother of Ona and Salome Friesen. It would be an appropriate symbol act representing our service to each other, she said, just as Jesus washed the feet of his disciples at the Last Supper, knowing that his hour had come. Four of the eight women are wearing plastic sandals with white socks, two are wearing sturdy leather shoes scuffed with white socks, and the other two, the youngest, are wearing torn canvas running shoes also with white socks. Socks are always worn by the women of Malochna, and it appears to be a rule that the top of the socks must always reach the bottom hem of the dress. The two youngest women, Orchi and Netchi, the ones wearing running shoes, have rolled their socks down rebelliously and stylishly into little donuts that encircle their ankles. On them a swatch of bare skin, several inches of skin is visible between the rolled socks and the dress hem, and insect bites, probably black fly and chigger, dot the skin. Faint scars from rope burns or from cuts are also visible on the exposed part of these women. Orchi and Netchi, both 16, are having difficulty keeping straight faces during the foot washing, murmuring to each other that it's ticklish, and coming close to erupting in giggles when attempting to say God bless you to each other in solemn voices, as their mothers, aunts and grandmothers have done following each washing. Greta Lowen, the eldest of the Lowen women, begins. She exudes a deep, melancholic dignity as she speaks of her horses, Ruth and Trial. She describes how when Ruth and Trial are frightened by one or more of Duke's Rottweilers on the mile road that leads to church, their initial instinct is to bolt. We have seen it happen, she says. Greta explains that these horses, upon being startled by Duke's stupid dog, don't organize meetings to determine their next course of action. They run, and by so doing evade the dog and potential harm. Agatha Friesen, the eldest of the Friesen women, laughs, as she does frequently and charmingly, and agrees. But Greta, she states, we are not animals. Greta replies that we have been preyed upon like animals. Perhaps we should respond in kind. Do you mean we should run away, asks Sona, or kill our attackers, asks Salome. Note, as I have mentioned, Salome Friesen did assault the attackers with a scythe, whereupon the attackers were promptly rescued by Peters and the elders, and the police were called to the colony. At no other time in the history of Malochna have the police been called. The attackers were brought to the city for their own protection. Salome has since asked Peters and the elders to be forgiven for that indiscretion, but even so, her rage is barely suppressed Vesuvian. Her eyes are never still. Even if one day she runs out of words like a woman is said to run out of eggs, I believe that Salome will be able to communicate and to give life, fearsome life, to every emotion stemming from each injustice she perceives. There is no inward eye in Salome, no bliss of solitude. She doesn't wander, and she is not lonely. Her niece Netchi, used to the gentler styling of her late mother Mina, but now in Salome's care, keeps her distance. Netchi draws and draws, perhaps to balance the wild, lava-like outpouring of her aunt's words with solid, silent lines on paper. Agatha Friesen, unfazed by Salome's outbursts, states that in her lifetime she has seen horses, perhaps not Ruth or Kryl, Fair enough, in deference to Greta and her high regard for her horses, but others who, when charged by a dog or coyote or jaguar, have attempted to confront the animal and or to stomp the creature to death. So it isn't always the case that animals flee their attackers. Greta acknowledges this. Yes, she has seen similar behavior in animals. She begins once again to talk of Ruth and Krail, but her anecdote is cut shortly by Agatha. Agatha tells the group she has her own animal story, also featuring Duke's Rottweiler. She speaks quickly, often inserting asides and non-squitters in a hushed, theatrical voice. I am not able to hear or keep up with every detail, but I'll attempt here to tell the story in her voice and with as much accuracy as I am able. Duke had raccoons in his yard that he hated for a long time. And when the fattest raccoon suddenly had 6 babies, it was all that Duke could stand. He tore his hair out, he told his Rottweiler to go kill them, and away the dog went. And the mother raccoon was surprised and tried to save her babies and get away from the dog, but the dog killed 3 of the babies and the mother raccoon could only save the other 3. She took those babies and left Duke's yard. Duke was fairly happy about that. He drank his instant coffee and thought, praise be to God, no more raccoons. But a few days later, he looked into his yard and saw the 3 baby raccoons sitting there, and he became angry once again. He told his Rottweiler again to attack and kill them. But this time, the mother raccoon was waiting for the dog, and when he came running at the babies, she jumped on him from a tree and bit into his neck and his stomach, and then, with every muscle in her body, straining, dragged him into the bushes. Duke was so mad and also sad. He wanted his dog back. He went into the bushes to find the dog, but he couldn't, even after 2 days of searching. He cried. When he came back home, he walked despondently to his door, and there lay 1 leg from his dog and also the dog's head, with empty eye sockets. The reaction to Agatha's stories is mixed. Greta lifts her hands over her head and asks the other women, what are we supposed to make of this? Are we to leave our most vulnerable colony members exposed to further attack in order to lure the men to their death so they can be dismembered and delivered in parts to the doorstep of Peters, the bishop of our colony? What the story proves is that animals can fight back and they can run away, Agatha says. And so, it doesn't matter whether we are animals or not, or whether we have been treated like animals or not, or even if we can know the answer to that one or the other. Either way, it's a waste of time to try to establish whether we are animals or not, when the men will soon be returning from the city. Mary Clowen raises her hand. One of her fingers, her left index, has been bitten off at the knuckle. It is half as long as the middle finger next to it. She asserts that in her opinion, the more important question to ask is not whether the women are animals, but rather, should the women avenge the harm perpetrated against them? Or should they instead forgive the men and by doing so be allowed to enter the gates of heaven? We will be forced to leave the colony, she says, if we don't forgive the men and or accept their apologies. And through the process of this excommunication, we will forfeit our place in heaven. Merik sees me looking at her and asks if I am writing this down. I know, yes, I am. Satisfied, Merik asks the other a question about the rapture. How will the Lord, when he arrives, find all the women if we aren't in Molochna? Salome cuts her off, disdainful. In a mocking voice, she begins to explain that if Jesus is able to return to life, life for thousands of years and then drop down to earth from heaven to scoop up his supporters, surely he had also be able to locate a few women who. But now Salome is silenced by her mother Agatha with a quick gesture. We will return to that question later, Agatha says kindly. Merik's eyes dart around the room, perhaps searching for kinship on this subject, someone to share her fears. The others look away. Salome is muttering, but if we are animals or even animal-like, perhaps there is no chance any way of entering the gates of heaven, unless animals are permitted. Although that doesn't make sense because Animals provide food and labor, and we will require neither of those things in heaven. So perhaps, after all, Mennonite women will not be allowed into heaven because we fall into the category of animals who will not be needed up there, where it's always la 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 la. She ends her sentence in songs labels. The other women, except Ona Friesen, her sister, ignore her. Ona smiles slightly, encouragingly, approvingly, although it's also a smile that could serve as firm punctuation to Salome's statement, that is, a silent request to end it. Ona begins to speak now. She is reminded of a dream she had two nights ago. She found a hard candy in the dirt behind her home and had picked it up and taken it into her kitchen, planning to wash it and eat it. Before she could wash it, she was accosted by a very large 200-pound pig. She screamed, "Get the pig off me!" But it had her pinned against the wall. "That's ridiculous," said Merik. "We don't have hard candy in Malochna." Agatha reaches over to touch Ona's hand. "You can tell us your dreams later," she says, "when the meeting is over." Several of the women speak up now, saying that they are not able to forgive the men. "Precisely," says Marik. She speaks, sure of herself again. "Yet we want to enter the gates of heaven when we die." None of the women argue that point. Marik goes on to state that we should then not put ourselves into an unfortunate position where we are forced to choose between forgiveness and eternal life. "What position would that be?" asks Ona Friesen. "That position would be staying behind to fight," Marik says. "Because the fight would be lost to the men, and we would be guilty of the sin of rebellion and of betraying our vow of pacifism, and would finally be plunged deeper into submissiveness and vulnerability. Furthermore, we would be forced to forgive the men anyway if we wanted God to forgive us and to allow us into his kingdom." "But is forgiveness that is coerced true forgiveness?" asks Ona Friesen. "And isn't the lie of pretending to forgive with words but not with one's heart a more grievous sin than to simply not forgive? Can't there be a category of forgiveness that is up to God alone? A category that includes the perpetuation of violence upon one's children, an act so impossible for a parent to forgive that God, in his wisdom, would take exclusively upon himself the responsibility for such forgiveness? Do you mean that God would allow the parent of the violated child to harbor just a tiny bit of hatred inside her heart?" asks Salome. "Just in order to survive? A tiny bit of hate?" asks Mijil. "That's ridiculous. And from tiny seeds of hate, bigger?" "It's not ridiculous," says Salome. "A very small amount of hate is a necessary ingredient to life." "To life?" says Mijil. "You mean to waging war? I've noticed how you come alive in the act of killing." Salome rolls her eyes. "Not war, survival. And let's not call it hate." "Oh, and you'd prefer to call it an ingredient?" says Mijil. "When I must kill pigs, I hit the runts harder," says Salome, "because it's more humane to kill them with one swift blow than to torture them with tepid hacks, which your system." "I wasn't talking about killing pigs," says Mijil. During this exchange, Mijil's daughter, Otchi, has begun swinging from a rafter, a human pendulum, a kicking at bales, mid-swing and losing the straw, a piece of which has landed in Salome's hair. Mijil looks up, tells Otchi to behave herself. Can't she hear the rafter creaking? Does she want the roof to cave in? Mijil reaches for her pouch of tobacco but doesn't roll a smoke, simply rests her hand lightly on the pouch as though it were a gear shift in an idling getaway car. And she's waiting, knowing it is there when she needs it because her hand is on it. Salome doesn't know about the straw in her hair. It sits above her ear, nestled in that space like a librarian's number two pencil. After a small silence, Greta returns to Ona's question. "Perhaps, yes, such a category exists," she says slowly. "Except there's no biblical precedent for this type of God-only forgiveness." A brief observation about Ona Friesen. Ona is distinctive amongst these women for having her hair pulled back loosely rather than with the blunt force of a seemingly primitive tool. She is perceived by most of the colonists to have a gentle disposition and an inability to function in the real world. She's a spinster. She's afforded type of liberty to speak her mind. Because her thoughts and words are perceived as meaningless, although this didn't prevent her from being attacked repeatedly, she was a reliable target because she slept alone in a room rather than with a husband, which she doesn't have or want, it seems. Earlier, she had stated, "When we have liberated ourselves, we will have to ask ourselves who we are." Now, she asks, is it accurate to say that at this moment we women are asking ourselves what our priority is and what is right to protect our children or to enter the kingdom of heaven? Meja Lowen says no. That is not accurate. That is an exaggeration of what is truly being discussed. What then is truly being discussed? Una asks. Agatha Friesen, Una's mother, responds, "We will burn that bridge when we come to it," she says. And Ona, indulgent of her mother, as she is of her sister, is content to let it be. I must record here that Greta Lowen's eyes are opening and closing, and often tears roll down her cheeks. She's not crying, she says, she's moisturing. Netchi Friesen and Otchi Lowen are restless in their chairs and are half-heartedly playing some type of clapping game, their hands hidden beneath the table. I suggest that we adjourn for a short period, and the women approve. Agatha Friesen suggests that we sing a hymn before dispersing, and the others agree. The women join hands and sing, "Work, for the night is coming." Ona Friesen harmonizes spellbindingly the first verse of the hymn, "Work, for the night is coming. Work through the morning hours. Work while the dew is sparkling. Work mid springing flowers. Work when the day grows brighter, work in the glowing sun. Work, for the night is coming when man's work is done." The women continue to sing verses 2 and 3 with Netchi and Otchi crumple in defeat. Greta Lowen pats Otchi's hand, "Steady on." The knuckles on Greta's hand stand out like knobs, like desert buttes on a cracked surface. Her false teeth are too big for her mouth and painful. She removes them and sets them down on the plywood. They were given to her by a well-meaning traveler who had come to Malochna with a first aid kit after hearing about the attacks on the women. When Greta had cried out, the attacker covered her mouth with such force that nearly all her teeth, which were old and fragile, were crushed to dust. The traveler who gave Greta her false teeth was escorted out of Malochna by Peters, who then forbade outside helpers from entering the colony. The singing has ended. The women disperse. Note: Salome Friesen left earlier, exasperated after Ona asked if the women were discussing what was right, to protect the children or to enter the kingdom of heaven, and if it wasn't possible to do both. I hadn't the time then to write down the details of her departure. Agatha laughed gently when Salome left, telling the others that her daughter would be back, not to worry. Let her blow off steam, let her be, let her cheek on her children, Meep and Aaron. That would settle her. When it comes to her children, Salome's patience and tolerance knows no bound. But Salome's reputation in the colony is that of a fighter, an instigator. She doesn't react calmly to authority and is often engaged in a battle of wills with other colony members over the slightest of things. For example, once she hit the dining hall bell and claimed to have forgotten where she hid it. All because she resented the tone of the clang three bloody times a day, and particularly resented the pride that Sarah took in ringing the bell. She also turned Peter's rain barrel upside down during a massive downpour, shrieking that he was too pure to need washing water. Wasn't he? Wasn't he? I find it curious that she hasn't been excommunicated. Are her small acts of rebellion a convenient outlet for Peters? A type of performance that satisfies the colonists' need to assert themselves? And that allows Peters to act with impunity in larger issues? Another note. As Ona was leaving the loft, I managed to tell her that I liked her dream. The one about the pig? She laughed. I then mustered the courage to tell her a fact. Did you know, I said to Ona, that it is physically impossible for pigs to look up at the sky? Just then, in that moment, Ona looked up at me from her rung on the ladder. Like this, she said. This made me laugh. Ona left satisfied. She will be the one to look up to the sky, I thought. That is why the pig in her dream had her pinned against the wall. But then I thought, how could that be? How could my interpretation of Ona's dream be accurate when Ona wasn't aware, consciously or not, of the physical limitation of pigs? In my jail cell in England, my cellmates and I would play games. What would you prefer was the name of my favorite game. Knowing you were about to die, would you prefer 1 year, 1 day, 1 minute, or no time at all to live with that knowledge? The answer is none of the above. In jail, I once made the mistake of telling my cellmates that the sound of a duck made me happy and provided consolation. There are crimes, and then there are crimes. I have since learned to keep most of my thoughts to myself. We have reconvened, and I'm embarrassed. Outside, during our break, I met young Orchi at the pump. At first, we were silent. She pumped water vigorously, and I stared at the ground. Then she had filled her pail. I cleared my throat and mentioned to her that during the war, the Second World War in Italy, for example, specifically in Turin, but in many other places as well, civilians would hide in bomb shelters. Often these civilians were murdered, I added, for participating in the resistance. Orchi slowly crept away backwards, smiling and nodding. Yes, I said, also nodding and smiling. In these bomb shelters, volunteers were needed to power by riding a bicycle, the generators that provided electricity. When she was swinging from the rafter earlier with such vigor, it had reminded me of this fact and of the volunteers who had generated this energy by riding a bicycle. She would be the perfect volunteer to do just that. I told Orji if we were in a bomb shelter. Orji asked me, logically, where she would ride the bike to if we were in such an enclosed space. Ah, yes, I said. Well, the bike would be stationary. Orchi smiled and seemed to ponder this for a second or two. Then she reminded me that she had to get the water over the yearlings. First, though, she showed me how she could swing the pail of water around in a complete circle without spilling a drop. I smiled awkwardly. She ran towards the horses. I waved stupidly at her back and at the cloud of dust she left in her wake. I stood in the dirt, my shirt tailing flapping like an absurd flightless bird. Why had I mentioned the resistance and that civilians had been murdered for their defiance? It dawned on me that I had suggested she was susceptible to being executed. I wanted to run after Orji and apologize for scaring her, but that would have scared her even more. Or perhaps my words are as ridiculous to her as they are to me, which is comforting only a little. Salome has returned, her eyes like asteroids now. Planet-destroying asteroids. Since we concluded our first part of the meeting with a haim, I say to the women, would it be acceptable if I were to begin our next part with a fact that could act as a metaphor and inspiration? The women agree, although Marik frowns and goes to the window to look out as I speak. I thank the women and begin by reminding them that we, Mennonites of Malocha, came to settle this land by way of the Black Sea. Our members had for centuries inhabited the shores of the Black Sea, Odessa, and had experienced, until we began to be slaughtered, much peace and happiness. I state the fact the deep waters of the Black Sea do not mix with the upper layers of the water that receive oxygen from the atmosphere, making the deep waters anoxic, which means that they do not contain life. Anoxic conditions leave remarkably preserved fossils, and on those fossils, the images of soft body parts are visible. But where does that life come from? There are no low or high tides, so the surface of the Black Sea is always calm and serene. Yet underwater, there is a river, a mysterious river that scientists believe can sustain life in the bottom part of the Black Sea, the inhospitable part. But these scientists have no way of proving it. The women's reaction to the inspirational fact is once again mixed, with silence being the most common response. Ona Friesen, who is known to appreciate facts, thanks me. When she speaks, Ona ends her sentences with a brisk inhalation of breath, as though she is attempting to take back her words, as though what she has just said has startled her. Marie Thioen, who has been standing with her back to us, turns away from the window. Are you implying, she asks me, that the women should stay in Malochna rather than leave? That the upper layers of the Black Sea represent the men of the colony and the lower layers the women who would somehow mysteriously thrive in spite of being beneath the severe and lifeless pressure of the men? I am entirely to blame for this misunderstanding, I say, but I mean only to somehow convey that life and the preservation of life is a possibility even when circumstances appear to be hopeless. I meant it to be inspirational, I say. Marie reminds me that the women had asked me to take the minutes of their meetings only because I was able to translate and to write and I should not feel obliged to offer inspirational counseling. Salome Friesen quickly suggests to Marie that her reaction is inappropriate, whereupon Major Lowen reminds Salome once again that she has not been given special powers to declare what is or isn't appropriate. Maybe I've been, says Salome. By whom? Asks Mijil. Peters? God? The surface of Malochna, like the surface of the Black Sea, is always calm and serene, says Salome. Don't you understand? So what? Interrupts Mijil. Ona, intent on further examining the mysterious Black Sea scenario, asks, what is soft tissue exactly? It's the skin and the flesh and all the connective material, answers Agatha. It's anything that protects the heart tissue, like bones or anything rigid, I suppose. So, says Marie, the soft tissue protects the harder tissue, like the tissue that makes bones. The soft tissue is more, what would you call it? Resilient, and yet it decomposes much more quickly in the end. Unless it is preserved in the mysterious deep waters of the Black Sea, she adds, separating the woods, mysterious deep waters of the Black Sea, from the beginning of the sentence to give them historionic emphasis. I understand this to be mockery directed at myself. I smile. I dig my nails onto the top of my scalp. I say that soft tissue is often defined by what it is not. I suppose so, says Agatha. But, and yet it is stronger in a way, Marie interrupts, in that it has restorative qualities before the end. Well, says Agatha, perhaps, although, do you mean death, asks Ona, when you say the end? Marie makes a gesture. What on earth else would the end be, if not death? But Marie says, Greta, physical death is not the end of life. Orchi and Netji are ignoring the other women now and engaged in a private conversation of their own. Netji is nodding, smiling and glancing in my direction. I wonder briefly if Orji is mentioning our water pump conversation to Netji. Again, predictably, I behave stupidly and not consciously to the girls, who instantly look away. So, says Ona, we women are the soft tissues of Malochna, if the colony is a body. Or, says Salome, the colony is the Black Sea and we are its mysterious deep waters. I tried to tell you that. Marie laughs and sarcastically asks Salome what, in her divine wisdom, is mysterious about the women of Malochna. There's more mystery in the skin that forms on the top of my morning milk, she says. Ona acknowledges the mystery of the milk skin, nodding at Marie in an attempt, I think, at friendship or solidarity, kindness. Ona asks me if I wish to bestow upon the women any other inspirational facts. I rub the top of my head briskly, a simian instinct I picked up in prison. I felt it gave me a slim margin of time to compose my response to a question. A question. Ep, motherfucker, are you interested in having your brain smashed in? The gesture makes Ona laugh. Yes, I say. Humans shed approximately 40 pounds of skin in their lifetime, completely replacing their outer skin every month. Netji interrupts.
except for the scars, she says. Can they be replaced with fresh skin? No, says Archie. That's why they are called scars, idiot. The young women laugh and punch at each other without making contact. Ona muses that the replacement of their outer skin every month coincides with the replacement of their uterine lining also every month. How do you know that? Marik asks and Ona looks at me. This is something my mother had told Ona long ago in my mother's secret schoolhouse, which was not a physical place at all but a discussion that she called the secret schoolhouse. She held it for girls during milking when we were children, Ona and I, before I left Malochna with my parents. Marie glares at me and asks if I had explained things to Ona about her uterine lining. No, says Ona, not August. August's mother, Monica. Marie is silent. Salome comments that this explanation is probably useful, but shouldn't we move on? Ona, as if she has not heard Salome, mentions that if my fact is true, the skin the women, had during the attacks is gone now, has been replaced. She smiles. She looks as if she would say more, but now Agatha Friesen, sensing Salome's impatience and impending rage, briskly asks if we might put aside the animal or non-animal and forgiveness or non-forgiveness and inspirational or non-inspirational and soft tissue or hard tissue or new skin or old skin debates to concentrate on the matter at hand, which is whether to stay and fight or leave. The women agree that we should move on. Meanwhile, Salome has flung her milk pail to the side. It's wobbly and bothering her. Ona gets up, gives Salome her own pail to sit on, and retrieves Salome's wobbly pail for herself. Once she's sitting again, Ona Friesen continues to consider something said earlier. She mentions that Marique's use of the word counseling has brought to her mind another issue. She requests permission to make one more statement regarding forgiveness. The women agree. Ona speaks. If it has been decided by the elders and the bishop of Malochna that we women don't require counseling following these attacks because we weren't conscious when they happened, then what are we obliged or even able to forgive? Something that did not happen? Something that we are unable to understand? And what does that mean more broadly? If we don't know the world, we won't be corrupted by it. If we don't know that we are imprisoned, then we are free. The teenagers Nedji Friesen and Archie Lowen are now engaged in a contest using body language, attempting to outdo each other to convey their boredom and discomfort. Archie has pretended, for example, to have shot herself in the head by inserting a rifle into her mouth, then slumping over on her milk pail. Nedji has asked plaintively, "But are we staying or going?" She is resting her head on her arm. Her voice is muffled. Her palm is open facing upwards as though she is waiting for an answer or for a cyanide capsule to be placed inside that palm. She has removed her kerchief and I can see one long, thin, very white line running down the center of her scalp. It is naked skin, called a parting by the women. Greta Lowen sighs heavily. She says that although we may not be animals, we have been treated worse than animals, and that in fact Malochna animals are safer than the Malochna women and better cared for. Agatha Friesen reminds Greta that due to the issues of time, we have agreed to abandon the question of whether the women are animals or not. Greta waves aside Agatha's reprimand and closes her eyes. She is tapping her false teeth on the plywood. Marik interjects, "I believe the only solution is to flee." Oh, but the idea of fleeing has created an uproar amongst the women. They are talking at once, still talking at once, still talking at once. Ona looks at me, I look at the minutes. For nervousness, because of Ona's glance, I clear my throat, which the women took to be gesture of impatience on my part, an interruption. They stop talking. Marie glares at me. I stroke my throat as though it's ticklish, the beginning of an illness, perhaps strep-like, young Aaron's. I haven't meant to interrupt. I am an obstacle to Marie and possibly to Salome, who is impatient for other reasons like a sudden flood, like a chipped hoof. Now Salome Friesen asks aggressively Is this how we want to teach our daughters to defend themselves? By fleeing. Major Lowen interjects, not fleeing but leaving. We are talking about leaving. Salome Friesen acts as though she hasn't heard Mijil. Fleeing. I'd rather stand my ground and shoot each man in the heart and bury them in a pit than flee, and I'll deal with God's wrath if I have to. Salome, Ona says gently, please be calm. The Lowens are talking about leaving, not fleeing. The word fleeing was improperly used. Set it aside. Marik shakes her head at this. Indigenant. She apologizes sarcastically for using the incorrect word. A sin so outrageous that Salome, with her Olympian ears and almighty mind, must take it upon herself to rectify for the sake of all humanity. Salome strongly objects. She counter accuses Marik of being reckless with words. Leaving and fleeing are two vastly different words, she says, with different meanings and with specific implications. Orchie and Netchie have now begun to take some interest in the proceedings, both stifling giggles. Meanwhile, Greta and Agatha wear stern but resigned expressions that speak to years of experience with this type of uproar from their daughters. Agatha's hands are clasped and she is spinning her thumbs around each other. Greta is patting her own head. Ona Friesen is staring wistfully out of the north-facing window towards Canola Field, towards the hills and towards the border and a vision of her own making, perhaps. Mija Lohan has begun to roll herself a smoke. Well, August, says Agatha, she is sitting next to me. She has put her arm around my shoulder. What do you make of all this? Do you have an opinion too? What comes into my head is the story of the Korean poet Ko Un. So I tell the women how he had tried to commit suicide 4 times, once by pouring poison into one of his ears. He survived but destroyed his eardrum. The other eardrum had been damaged when he was a political prisoner and was tortured. During the Korean War, he was forced to carry dead bodies on his back. Then he became a monk for 10 years. The women have stopped arguing and are listening to my story about the poet. I stop speaking. Agatha asks, then what? Well, later, he became an alcoholic which saved his life when he again wanted to kill himself. This time with a larger stone and a rope in the sea between the Korean Peninsula and Jeju Island. Where is that? Asks Orchie. But she is shushed by her mother. It doesn't matter, says Mijo. Well, says Salome, it matters, but let August finish her story first. Agatha nods at me to continue. On the boat, I say they sold alcoholic drinks. Cohen thought, why not have one before dying? He had one drink, then a second, and a third. He got drunk and fell asleep. When he woke up, he was at the pyre. He had missed his opportunity to kill himself, and the others were waiting for him because he had heard that the legendary monk and poet Ko Un was coming to their island. They hoped that he would stay there. So he did, and he was very happy there for some years. After a pause, Mijil asks me if I'm finished, and I tell her that I am. The women do not speak but shuffle on their pails, clearing their throats. I mutter that Agatha had asked me if I had an opinion on debate over leaving versus fleeing. I had meant only to articulate my feelings about the meaning of meaning. How it is possible to leave something or someone in one frame of mind and arrive elsewhere in another entirely unexpected frame of mind. I'm already aware of that, says Mijil. Aren't we all? We are aware of many things instinctively, says Ona quietly, but to have them articulated in a certain narrative way is pleasing and fun. Salome Friesen tells the women that she has no time for pleasing and fun. May I be excused, she asks sarcastically, since it is lunchtime and my turn to bring food to a few of the elders of the colony as well as administrator, my youngest daughter's antibiotics. Salome's youngest daughter, Meep, was violated by the men on 2 or possibly 3 different occasions, but Peters denied medical treatment for Meep, who is 3 years of age, on the grounds that the doctor would gossip about the colony and the people would become aware of the attacks and the whole incident would be blown out of proportion. Salome walked 12 miles to the next colony to procure antibiotics for Meep from the mobile clinic that she knew was stationed there. temporarily for repairs. I have to hide antibiotics in meat strain or she won't swallow them, says Salome. The women nod and tell her to go. As she leaves, Salome suggests that if Mijal goes to get the soup for the summer kitchen, then Salome could bring the spelt bread she baked this morning. We will all have this food for lunch, Salome says, and continues with our meetings as we eat. We will have instant coffee. Mijal shrugs. She hates to be told what to do by Salome, but rises from her chair. Agatha, meanwhile, remains perfectly still, mouthing the words to a prayer or a verse. Meep has a granddaughter named after her. Agatha is a strong woman, but whenever she hears the specific details of the attack on her tiny granddaughter, she becomes very still, predatory. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in loving kindness and forgiving, says Agatha. She repeats this and Greta takes Agatha's hand and joins her in the recitation. Mijal Lowen has left the room, I presume to smoke, even though she has declared that she is going to get the soup from the summer kitchen. She ordered Ochi, her daughter, not to follow her, and Ochi made a face as if to say, why would I bother? And also a face to others as if to apologize for her strange mother, the smoker with the secret life. Meep and the other little children from the colony are being looked after by several young women at the home of Nettie Gerbrand, whose husband is away in the city with the others. Nettie Gerbrand's twin brother, Johan, is one of the eight on trial. Meep herself is unaware of why she experiences pain in certain parts of her small body, or that she has a sexually transmitted illness. Nettie Gerbrand, too, was attacked, possibly by her brother, and gave birth prematurely to a baby boy so tiny he fit into her shoe. He died hours after being born, and Nettie smeared her bedroom walls with blood. She has stopped talking, except to the children of the colony, which is why she has been put in charge of their care while the others work. Marie Clowen believes that Nettie may have changed her name to Melvin. She believes Nettie has done this because she no longer wants to be a woman. Agatha and Greta refuse to believe this. I ask for a quick breather. Ona Friesen once again glances at me inquisitively, or perhaps she is curious at the notion of a breather, or at the notion of the sustained breath, the exquisite agony of the unexpressed thought, the narrative of life. The thread that binds, the knots that holds. A breather, breath sustained. The narrative. The women give me their consent. I have returned to the meeting. I am alone, waiting for the women. When I was out, I heard music coming from a truck. It was the song California Dreamin', sung by the mamas and the papas on a radio turned to an oldies station. I stood 100 meters from the truck, which was on the main road that runs along the perimeter of the colony. Ochi and Netchi were standing beside it listening. There were few sounds other than the voices of the mamas and the papas in such sweet harmony, singing about the safety and warmth of Los Angeles, the dream of it. The girls didn't see me, I'm quite sure. They stood perfectly still beside the driver's side of the truck, their necks bent, heads down as though they were forensic detectives listening for clues or solemn mourners at a gravesite. Before the song had played, the driver of the truck made a public announcement on his loudspeaker, which he had attached to the cab. He was an official census taker and he insisted that all the colonists must come out of their homes to be counted. He made this announcement several times, but of course there were only women mostly now in the colony and they don't understand his language, and even if they did, they would not leave their homes, the barn, the summer kitchen, the yearling pen, the chicken coops, the laundry building, to be accounted for by a man driving a truck with a radio turned into a pop station. Except for Orgy and Nedji, of course, who were drawn to the truck like lost sailors to sirens. Now, as I wait for the women to return to the meeting, I have the song California Dreamin' in my head and earworm. I imagine teaching the women the lyrics to the song, having them harmonize like the mamas and the papas repeating the lyrics, a call and response. I think they would enjoy it. All the leaves are brown. I gaze around the empty space, hearing their voices. These meetings are taking place in the hayloft, belonging to the Ernest Thyssen, one of the elderly and infirm men who has not traveled to the city. Ernest is oblivious to most things, including the fact that the women are using his hayloft for their meetings. He cannot remember how many children he has had or if his siblings are alive or dead. But one thing he has never forgotten is that Peter stole his clock. Ernest's father had left Ernest the family's cherished clock when he died, knowing that Ernest, of all of his sons and daughters, was most bound by and fascinated by the nature of time. Peters insisted that the Ernest hand over the clock, telling him that the time in Malochna was eternal, that life on earth naturally flowed into life in heaven if one was pure in God's eyes, and therefore that time and clocks was irrelevant. It was discovered months later that Peter had installed the clock in his study, the room in his house where he planned his sermons and conducted colony business. Ernest, although senile, has never forgotten his stolen clock, as though this one injustice has expanded to take up all of his mind, as though he has been appointed as the keeper of this one injustice to the exclusion of all else. And when he sees Peter's, he always asks him, when, at what time will he return the clock? The women prefer to meet in this hayloft rather than at the one of their kitchen tables, because in the kitchen there are children everywhere and always underfoot. It's not unusual for a family to have 15 children or 25 children. Our table consists of hay bales with a piece of plywood laid across them, and our chairs are milking buckets. Orchi and Netchi occasionally take turns sitting on the window ledge with their legs up and bent at the knees, or in saddles that they've removed from the Ernest Thyssen's tack room and set up on a moldy beam here in the loft. Ona Friesen keeps an empty feed pail beside her because she is pregnant and is experiencing nausea. Several of the women in the colony attempted hurriedly when it was clear that Ona was expecting to marry Ona to Julius Penner, the simple son of Andrzej Penner. But Ona insisted that Julius deserved better than a woman afflicted with Narfa, and that he would be tainted with sin for marrying a woman who was not a virgin. The elders of the colony have concluded that Ona is beyond redemption, that her Narfa has rendered her incapable of reasoning. I feel obliged to point out that this criticism from the elders is saturated in irony, and that Ona will be exempt from the eternal dimension because she has not willfully sinned. Her unborn child, a product of the unwelcome visitor, as the rapists are referred to by the elders, will be given to another colony family to raise as their own, perhaps even to the family of the unwelcome visitor. Now the women are returning, with the exception of Orchi and Netchi. Marie Clowen explains that the young women are at the end of Ernest Thyssen's driveway, visiting with the Koop brothers from Kortza, the neighboring colony. The other women frown, but conquer that we must begin without them. Salome asked Mijal if she was smoking, and Mijal asked Salome if that is any of her business. The two of them have brought the bread and soup and instant coffee from the summer kitchen and are serving portions of it for the women and for me. Greta and Agata begin the meeting by stating that it is imperative that we make a decision this afternoon about staying or leaving. But as they finish speaking, Orji and Netji return to the hayloft, and now they are entertaining us with an amusing stunt. Before joining us in the loft, they secretly positioned a flatbed wagon, carrying stacks of bales underneath the window. Orchi climbs the ladder first, moaning hysterically about not being able to live a second longer, about life being too cruel. She sways and moans, then runs to the window and flings herself out of it head first. The women scream and we all sprint and hobble to the window to find Orchi sitting placidly atop stacks of bales. Ona laughs hard in appreciation while the others shake their head and strive to contain any sign of approval. The women resume their seats at the table. Netchi mentions that Koop brothers told her and Orchi that the brother's father had been in the city selling cheese and had bumped onto Ingersoll. Ingersoll was in the city with the other men from Malochna and had stepped outside the courtroom to check on his team. He had told their father, who had mentioned it to their other brother, who then mentioned it to the Coop boys, that the two of the Malochna men were planning to return early to get extra livestock and possibly horses to auction in the city for more bail money. Greta has lifted her arms into the air. Agatha sharpened her grays and is very still. How early? Marik asks, and the young women shrug. Which men? Marik asks. One of them is class, says Netchi. Marik takes a slender chicken bone from her mouth and lays it next to her bowl and makes the smallest of small sounds. Ona hands me a large roll of brown paper, the kind used to packet cheese and meat. She tells me that she has taken it from the summer kitchen. My mother Monica used to give me cheese packaging paper to draw on when I was young. Ona suggests that I use the packaging paper to make lists of pros and cons for the women's options. These needs to be written on a large piece of paper. None of the women will be able to read what you write, says Ona, but we will keep it here in Hayloft as an artifact for the others to discover. Archie and Nedji exchange glances. What is Ona talking about now? Why is she so strange? How can we prevent ourselves from becoming like her? Yes, a discovery, says Selom. Agatha nods impatiently and moves her hand in rapid circles like a buggy wheel, meaning, can we please proceed? Mijal finds nails in the tack room and a salt block to hammer the packaging paper to the wall. Ona suggests I write the first heading to read as follows, staying and fighting. Beneath that, I write a second subheading, pros. At this, the women begin speaking over one another, and I have no choice but to politely and with apologies request that they may take turns speaking so that I can understand what each one of them is saying and have several seconds to transcribe it onto the paper. Pros. We won't have to leave. We won't have to pack. We won't have to figure out where we are going or experience the uncertainty of not knowing where we are going. Selom scoffs at this last point, calling it absurd. The only certainty we'll know is uncertainty, she says, regardless of where we are. Ona asserts, other than the certainty of the power of love. Selom turns to face Ona directly. Keep inanities such as these to yourself, she pleads. Mijal defends Ona. Why couldn't that be the case? That the only certainty is the power of love, she wonders. Because it's meaningless, Selom shouts, particularly in this fucking context. Agatha sharply rebukes her daughters. Then, deflection, she points to the younger women. Orchi, Nedji, she says, do you have something to add to the list? Selom is tearing off silvers of her fingernails with her teeth and eating them. Mijal grimaces in disgust as Selom spits out the nails. We won't have to leave the people we love, says Nedji. Greta points out that the women could bring loved ones with them. Other questions, the practicality of this, and Ona mentions gently that several of the people we love are people we also fear. We could create the possibility of a new order right here in a place that is familiar to us, Marik adds.